So Flo, I met you at the Minuteman Airfield open house.
Yes.
And you talked while I was filming, and you were interested that I was from Stow TV. And you mentioned that you had made a film. And I asked to see it, and you sent it to me. And I was blown away. It was a wonderful film.
Thank you.
Oh, it was really well done. And you asked, you said to me that you wanted to learn how to do video, and I saw that, and I was like, well, I could learn things from you.
Wow, that's a big compliment.
Well, I'm glad that you were able to give me the film to show.
I'm happy to share.
Well, thank you. But I want to hear about how you made it and why you made it. This is about Isabel Crook, a Canadian anthropologist who studied in China, and she is now 105?
She is now 105, but she will be 106 next month in December.
Wow.
So I want this, you and me, the interview showing on Stow TV about her film will be her 106 years old birthday gift.
What day is that?
December 15th.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yep. 106th birthday. Yeah, that's what our next schedule is. Oh, that's great. So why did you make this film?
First of all, I met her like 10 years ago. As our friendship growing, I want to visit her like every week. But when she was 102 years old, she fell and hurt her head. And every time I went to her house, her apartment, so many people pay respect to her. And she did a lot of contribution for China. And Chinese people will never forget about that. And they pay great respect to her. And what she did in China, she did an anthropology study and went to rural China area and record all these revolutions or normal people's life in her diary, in her notes. And her house, her room is filled up with notes she did like probably 80 years ago and books. And she helped found the Beijing Foreign Language University, which now is about 81 languages people can study. Yeah. So
are these all Asian languages or different languages?
No, different languages from all over the world. Yeah. And so I think, you know, people pay lots of respect, and Chinese people like to remember her story. But because her age, and I'm the only person close to her, because I'm kind of like she adopted a granddaughter, and I call her grandma. So because of this close relationship, I have the opportunity, or this is my responsibility to film that, because what her memory is kind of like a century book. It's like a history book, so valuable. And but after she fell, she broke her head, I can tell she's losing her memories and speak very slowly. So I said, I have to do something. Okay, so I borrowed a camera from my friend. Then every day I went to see grandma, see Isabel Crook. And after her nap, take a nap, I already set up a camera there. And when we have afternoon tea, we talk about, you know, life, talk about stories. And because I'm so close to her, she's not afraid of the camera. And make the interview going easier, because there were so many people want to interview her, and so many TVs want to interview her. But because her age, and she used to can speak Chinese, but when she got older, she lost the ability. She can't. She can only speak English. Yeah. So. I said, okay, I will take this responsibility to do this. And it's such an honor. So I filmed her about 2 months every day. It's not easy, actually. but I gained a lot, because when I type all the what she told me, the stories, and I showed to her son. Her son said, wow, those stories she never told me. You dig them out. And also her, you know, she is an anthropologist. She has some ideas, yeah, about life, about society. Yeah, so I'm really happy I record that. And also, after the movie is done, I presented as her 103 years old birthday gift. And I also organized a big event for her birthday. About 400, more than 400 people came. Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
and people, I really appreciate what she did for China, and people just love her so much.
Now, is she in Canada or right now or China? Where is she?
She's in China. Hmm. Yeah. Actually, she was born in China, in Sichuan province, which the panda come from. Oh. And she told me when she was young, she spent like summer time on the mountain, which I showed in the movie. And because in that area we have lots of bamboos, and we use the bamboo to do everything, like make everything. So the chair is made from bamboo. And she says, the wild panda come to bite the chair.
Because they eat bamboo.
Yes, because they eat bamboo, yeah. Actually, in those days, she said, some people from Canada, they took a panda to Canada, like 100 years ago, by ship. Yeah.
Wow. In the film you made, you have two young girls that represent her and is it her sister?
Yeah, so she has three sisters. So she's the oldest one. Then the second, the younger sister in UK now, she is 101 years old, 100, yeah, kind of like that. Mm. And the youngest sister is in Canada. She is 99 years old, like that.
Wow.
Yeah. So this family, they have a long life. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
I guess. Mm. So in the film, you have the girls singing a song, Long Winding River. What is that song from?
It's like a children's song from that local area. Yeah. So it's a kind of like a small poet, yeah. And the thing is, after my documentary, and more TV station want to interview her, but she can't go anywhere. So I brought all the TV crew, went to the Tibetan area in China, and where she started her first anthropology research, like 84 years ago, or when she was 21, 22 years old. Yeah, so she graduated from Canada and went back to China and did the anthropology study. And I went there, the house still there. It's made from stones, rocks.
Oh, that's the house where she lived with somebody's aunt?
Yes, and there is a little girl. She was, the little girl, she was 9, 8 years old. And in 2019, I went there to visit her, and she was 90 years old. And she can still remember. She can't even speak the Mandarin, you know, because she's from the Tibetan area, and she's Jia Rong, Tibetan minority. So she can speak the local language, but she barely can speak the Mandarin. But she can still remember the song Isabel Crook taught her like 84 years ago, 80 uh-huh. years ago. Yeah, so we did, we used, I called Isabel's son and in Beijing, so we did a FaceTime. So she, the girl, the little girl, which is now 89 years old, 90 years old, and she was saying that with me, and Isabel in Beijing with her son is singing the same song. Mm-hmm. So we filmed that. It's so funny, it's an English song, and this lady can't even remember, can't even speak Mandarin, but she can sing the English song Isabel taught her.
Wow.
Yeah.
So Isabel was taught that song as a child when she was in China?
Yes.
Neat. Well, it's a wonderful film. I really enjoyed it, and that's really well done. One thing I was wondering, at the end, there's a picture of you as the director, and you're wearing a big, I'm not sure what it is.
That's Miao minority clothes. It's here, you call it Mao, I think. It's in China, we have 56 minorities. Yeah, so each minority, they have their own customs, they have their clothes, they have their culture, some have their language, they have their own song. Yeah, it's fascinating. I'm kind of half. I'm half Han and half Tujia minority. Yeah.
Oh, it's a beautiful headpiece.
Yeah, supposed to be made from silver, because in those days they have wool, so the most treasure thing they make it as a clothes, put on their so they can wear them, and when start a war, they can just wear them and go.
Wow.
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, but now it's a different culture, different, it's so diversity. There is no war. China is union, it's one country together. Everybody is happy. Yeah.
And this is what Isabel had studied, and she lived through all those changes.
Yes, so it's amazing. It's quite like a history story, a history book. And I'm glad she has a record, and she did the notes, and she published a book about rural China she studied later, after Tibetan area. She studied later in Sichuan province called Xinlongchang. She published it when she was like 99 years old.
Wow.
Yeah. It's amazing.
That is amazing. Huh. And her husband had a book. She put together her husband's pictures that he took while he was there.
Yeah, her husband has an amazing story too. Her husband is from UK, but he's Jewish. And so in that time, only China, Shanghai opened the door for Jewish. So before that, her husband, David Crook, joined the Spanish War and met Hemingway, met Bethune, who is a doctor from Canada. And he met Bethune, and Bethune encouraged him to go to China. And so in that time, the Second World War, only China, Shanghai opened the door for Jewish people. So he went to China, and but in that time, China has against the Japanese war. So when the Japanese tried to invade China, they're from the east. So all the schools, so he was in Nanking and Shanghai. So they have to move all the people because they don't want the war, you know. So they moved to the west and the southern China. Mm-hmm. So all the universities set up there. And so that's how he met Isabel Crook, Isabel. So, and that Huaxi University, now still in Sichuan province, Isabel's parents worked for there. Yeah. So they met there, and after they went to UK to get married, and then Isabel was studying her PhD. Then David Crook still worked for the UK Air Force.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
she joined the Canadian Army.
Yes, yes. So he joined the UK Air Force. So they both fought for the Second World War. And she also told me during that time she worked in factory to build, I don't know what did she build, probably some supplies for the war, for the Second World War.
Oh.
Yeah, so she worked in the factory, and she also studied anthropology. Yeah, and after the war is over, the Second World War is over, so David gets some money from the Royal Air Force, said, okay, the war is over, we can send you to wherever you want to go. So she said, Isabel said, well, I'm from China, so how about we go back to China? So they back to China, but in that time, China still have war. The New Republic of China is not founded yet. So they went back to China in 1946, 47, kind of like that. They went there, went to the rural country China, you know, area. And they, both of them did notes, and the couple, so Isabel and her husband, published two books, yeah, there. And then after that, they planned to back to London, and the China, the generals asked them to stay, said the New Republic of China will be start soon. Please stay to help to teach people English, because in the future we need ambassadors. So they helped found the university.
Wow.
Yeah. And since then they taught there for the rest of their life. Yeah, they write the English book to teach Chinese people.
Wow. Well, it's a fascinating story.
Yeah.
And
Chinese always remember, you know, what they have done for Chinese people. So they want, you know, they always pay respect to her. So I'm lucky I got a chance to record this. Yeah, and to show Chinese people, yeah, their story.
And the American people.
Yes, I'm excited about that.
Well, did a great job, and thank you for sharing.
I always want to build the relationship, the friendship. You know, United States helped China a lot in those days too. Yeah, so that's why I have a song. Actually, this song is right in 1915, which Isabel Crook was born in 1915. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Is it the river, the Winding River song?
The farewell song, yeah. So the it's an American melody, and it's a Chinese poet combined together.
Nice. Is that one of the ones you played with on the island?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, great. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. And thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share the story, the documentary of Isabel.
That was 100 years ago.
It's that lovely picture. It's that they were both foreign students. They weren't married. They were just young, new arriving missionaries. And they were both, they were sent to this school for these, there must have been about 8 of them. And they're studying, they're sent up to Bailudin to do their language study.
Two young Canadians working so hard on their Chinese language study could never have dreamed they would bring forth a young anthropologist, Isabel Crook, who would make studies of China. Yet 100 years later, their daughter can still recall her days in Bailuding. Isabel Crook, whose life has spanned over a century, anthropologist and author of studies on China, has lived a remarkable life, matching her amazing age. Late in the Qing Dynasty, groups of Canadian missionaries boarded ships in Vancouver bound for Shanghai, where they travelled by boat up the Yangtze into Sichuan. In 1912, Isabel's father, Homer Brown, arrived in Chengdu, where he eventually became Dean of Education at West China Union University.
So he's a farm boy. He was brought up on a farm. He's a good farmer. Very proud of being in the countryside.
Inheriting this family trait, Isabel held no fear for the hardships of rural life, joyfully spending long stints in Chinese villages to do research. Isabel's mother, Muriel Hockey, like her father, Homer Brown, graduated from Victoria College in Toronto. After her marriage, she founded the first Montessori kindergarten in China, now the Golden Fruit Kindergarten, and served on the boards of the Chengdu Deaf, Blind and Dumb School, now the Chengdu Special School, as well as the Chengdu Canadian School. In 1915, Muriel Brown founded the Dewey School, now the Hongzhuan Xilu Primary School. That same year, Isabel was born in a house across the road from the Sersheng-se Church. Her parents gave her a Chinese name, Rao Shu Mei, meaning kindly plum blossom. And indeed she was kindly and bold as the plum blossom.
She was a remarkable woman, and she had the worst conditions under which to do it.
Muriel, who had set up schools and devoted herself to education, wished her daughter Isabel to continue this work and arranged for her to study child psychology back in Canada.
I was interested in anthropology.
For her master's degree, Isabel chose anthropology. On graduation at the age of 23, this smart young lady returned to China and decided to make a study of the Yi people in Sichuan's Hunyuan County.
Yes, they're very, very supportive because they think if I want to be an anthropologist, that's a worthwhile thing to understand society and how you develop society. Yes, they were very supportive. I'm very lucky.
Later, Isabel hiked up the Min River Valley to make a study in the Jiarong Tibetan areas of Lixian.
Certainly the national minorities in China, how do they live? What are their houses like? So I just arranged to go and live in a farmhouse that was empty. And the owner of it organized his aunt to live with me. So the two of us lived in his house, his empty house. And you know, going across those rivers was very interesting because you could swing There's a swing. Swing across and you drop yourself quickly on that side because it's going to swing back.
The ways of Shu are hard, harder than scaling the heavens. A young miss born in a large city to a Western missionary family, how was it she had the courage to hike in the wild hills, to brave the swift waters, to cross torrential rivers on a sliding cable?
This is my Bailu Dia.
We started going to Bailudin when we were very small.
Every summer, Isabel's family would make a 2 to 3 day journey to Bailudin on foot.
Bailudin was a very lovely place. It was a lovely place, Bailudin. Oh, because it's cool. And it's beautiful. And they fix it up. I mean, they have tennis courts and whatnot. So some people just go there and play tennis, and others go there, but they go climbing in the mountains around. And that's, we were those that climbed in the mountains.
When little Isabel's gaze peered beyond the clouds and forests and wild blossoms, and saw the low-thatched houses, the coolie carriers, the boatmen towing the boats up the rivers, it made her want to understand the mystery of how Chinese society was structured. In 1940, 25-year-old Isabel and 26-year-old Yu Shiji, two young beauties, one Chinese, one foreign, with sticks to beat off the dogs, went from house to house to survey the 1,500 households in the village of Prosperity in Sichuan's Bishan County. 73 years later, in 2013, the seminal work, Prosperity's Predicament, Identity, Reform and Resistance in Rural Wartime China, the first socio-anthropological work to be co-authored by a Chinese and a Western woman, was published. This work revealed in great detail everyday life in the hinterland of China during the Japanese War. It well deserves to be required reading for the Republican period on the rural reconstruction movement. She recalls how at night time in Prosperity, there were always little specks of light. These were from carriers lighting up their opium pipes in the inns. For them, food was secondary to having their opium. While clearly against opium, Isabel didn't rush to accuse these hard-working carriers. They all smoked opium. They simply could not carry on without it. Isabel explains in her book, those peasants who had lost their land and become carriers sought relief from opium. It cured them of dysentery and gave them hope of more strength. Objective in her observations, Isabel was filled with sympathy for the common people. Where did this insight come from? On their way to Bailuding, little Isabel liked to engage the locals in conversation. Her grandmother, helping their cook's family go to school, sowed a seed of compassion in her heart. In 1942, Isabel married David Crook, who joined the British RAF. Later, she joined in the anti-fascist struggle by enlisting in the Canadian Army.
Right.
But I'm very lucky because David really, he doesn't see any difference between men and women. That it doesn't matter what they are able to do and what they want to do and what their emotions are. You know, he can just takes them as they are. And I think that's one of his best, well, I shouldn't say best, it's one of his very good qualities.
After demobilization in 1946, Isabel embarked on a PhD in anthropology at LSE under Professor Raymond Firth. In 1947, Isabel and David sailed the oceans, crossing the blockade to enter China's liberated areas, ending up in the village of Ten Mile Inn, deep in the Taihung Mountains of South Hebei. There they made a detailed study of the entire land reform process. She reported her findings to Professor Firth, working on her PhD. Who was to foresee that passing these materials would lead to her wrongful detention for 3 years during the Cultural Revolution?
Of course, that was a very romantic, revolutionary time at that time. So everything was beautiful, you know, people were enthusiastic. And yes, so that's why so much was accomplished. Everybody was inspired. It's an inspiring thing, you know. I think it's, you can do, when you're inspired by the, you know, the support you're given by the local people, you know, it gives you a lot of energy.
They used not only their pens and typewriters, but their cameras, making detailed and complete records. 10 Mile Inn, Revolution in a Chinese Village, was published in London, and 20 years later, Mass Movement in a Chinese Village was published in New York. These two valuable works help people in the West to learn the truth about China's land reform.
Yes, well, we were working together. I mean, the work was done by both of us.
Isabel and David not only wrote together, they also taught side by side. After their land reform study, they were invited by the CPC to stay and teach. Working together on the first English textbook in the New China, they helped train diplomats and English teachers, devoting themselves to the cause of education in China. After teaching, Isabel maintained her interest in rural development. Isabel and David paid two more visits to 10 Mile Inn in 1959 and 1961, leading to the book First Years of Yang Yi Commune, published in England in 1966. This was designated as required reading by many social anthropologists in Britain. From 2011 to 2015, age between 96 and 100, Isabel carefully examined thousands of photos taken by David. For the text for the book, China Through the Lens of David Crook, 1938 to 1948, analysis of her notes and studies gives her belief that rural and urban development should be balanced, like yin and yang. Having lived through China's 20th century changes, the warlord period, the Japanese War, the War of Liberation, socialist construction and reform and opening, the memory of Bai Lu Ding has accompanied Isabel through her rich and varied life from where her dreams began.
I mean, these mountains are, it takes quite a time to climb up. And you have to go down each day to get your, buy your milk and whatnot.
The legendary life of this 103-year-old Western anthropologist is itself a valuable record of China. Just as she nurtured the flowers in her garden each evening in Bai Lu Ding, Isabel Crook has nurtured those dreams her entire life.
Yes, I thought it was valuable, and I'm very proud that I did that, because, you know, if you don't do it, it might easily be completely lost. You've got to have some records. Yeah.
Isabel Brown was Canadian. She was born long ago in Sichuan. 25 years later, she met David Crook in China. Later, they were wed in London. Together, they both worked as teachers, aided the struggle in many ways. The peasants and workers fought for their lives on the road to build a new day. They joined with their Chinese comrades on the road that was often not straight, unwavering as it got rocky, with commitment that was innate. Isabel Brown was Canadian. She was born long ago in Sichuan. 25 years later, she met David Crook in China. Later, they were wed in London. Together, they both worked as teachers, aiding the struggle in many ways. As peasants and workers fought for the land. lives on the road.